Friends, I'm delighted to speak with you on this occasion on the release of the report which highlights the Indian pharmaceutical industry's contribution to social initiatives from the leading companies. I would say that at the outset itself that the industry inherently participates in social initiatives. Given the nature of the business itself that we are in the pharmaceutical industry, access to affordable medicines is a key purpose itself for which the companies exist in the first place. And this has been ably demonstrated in the pandemic times by all the companies by providing uninterrupted supply of medicines, by providing the COVID treatments. And now they're in the forefront of providing vaccines, developing and also supplying vaccines. And also, I would say exceptional efforts have been made by the companies in providing the relief efforts during the pandemic times, in the early days of the pandemic, especially when we had the issue of the migrant workers. Each pharma company has done a stellar work in providing the relief work. So if you see the founders, of most of the successful pharma companies in India, they've traditionally been known for their very philanthropic bent of mind. They went beyond their call of duty to engage in activities for the benefit of the society. And this was done either by, their contributions which they made to nonprofit organizations, the NGOs, or they did it through their own foundations or the trusts which they set up. For example, Dr. Anji Reddy, my father, founder of our company, he had started way back in 1998 a research foundation called Dr. Reddy's Foundation, which goes by his name. And he was a believer in active philanthropy. So it was again interestingly prompted by a shareholder who had asked him in one of the AGMs saying, it's like, Dr. Reddy, you've built a successful company. You've given so much of returns to shareholders. What have you done for the society? And there was a little bit of a provocation in him. And he said, he's not going to continue with just donating through charity or giving it to trusts. He actually said he would do something himself and immediately set up this foundation. Subsequently, 2 years later, he also set up the Nandi Foundation, but this was more at the behest of the then chief minister of the combined Andhra Pradesh, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, but Dr. Reddy's foundation was the primary vehicle for him. So this foundation, for example, was in the area of livelihoods, it was in education, and now recently in the last 3 years, it's also been in healthcare as the main areas of activity. And you have seen, all of us have seen that in 2009, the guidelines for voluntary CSR were introduced by the government. And then it was made mandatory as a spend in 2013, which gave again, I think, companies an opportunity to also expand their CSR activity in a way that can benefit the society at a much larger scale. Right. So, I mean, again, madam, I just wanted to request you that time and again, we keep creeping about some of the regulations which the MCA has when it comes to this CSR spend, where we should spend, how we should spend and all that. I would request you to use your good offices, because Indian pharmaceutical companies especially have done exceptional work, right? So we really don't need that much of regulations for it. We are quite responsible in the way we spend. So also a lot of companies, so that I thought I would just mention that to you. And if you see, it's 6 years since the enactment of the law, the pharmaceutical industry has swiftly adapted their strategies, their CSR strategies, to also reach the most remote areas, especially in the rural areas, especially to serve the most underserved and vulnerable population. And as Sudarshan just mentioned, if you see the CSR initiatives of our member companies, we have focused primarily on health. We have used expertise in the areas of health, being closely associated in this industry, to cater to different needs of the underserved population. And while not limiting ourselves to the focus on health, we have expanded our activities to areas in education, community, and also rural infrastructure. Important to note, that we have done it silently. We have not made much of a noise about it, but importantly, we have created a huge impact. So I think the question obvious in everybody's mind is, so why this report at this point of time? Why are we projecting, what the work has been done? One of the things is, it's like listed companies, most of the companies, we already anyway report it in our annual reports, and there'll be much more reporting now with the additional guidelines which have been proposed, especially by the MCA on this, what they call the BRSR reporting, Business Responsibility and Sustainable Report, which means more of non-financial reporting, which will come into the forefront, but also it gives a framework for reporting things that highlight, responsible business, which is an emerging trend in the corporate governance. And it's just not just reporting, it's also an opportunity to showcase the impact, being created by the companies, and also find areas, like Priya had said in the beginning, to also find areas where, companies can partner with each other, and that maybe a larger impact could actually emerge. For example, pharma clusters in a particular region, if you see the pharma clusters, maybe they could pool resources, they could address high impact areas, especially whether it's health or education, which is where most of the companies spend their CSR money, and also use the some kind of a PPP model, to also work with the government. Because if you've seen the SDG goals, especially number three, which says SDG goal number three, which says good health and well-being, lots more can be done in healthcare, especially through this private-public partnership. And we can spread awareness, we can build the capacity in healthcare, lots of things that can be done. So I think going forward, the pharmaceutical industry, I believe, will play an even more crucial role, especially considering the magnitude of the challenges that we'll face because of the after effects of the pandemic. That's definitely there, because if you see from the economic side, globally itself, the GDP is expected to contract 5.2%, and the pandemic will plunge a lot of countries into recession in this year itself. And also, if you see the number of undernourished people, for example, WHO mentions that currently what's at 690 million, it could increase to almost 610 million, which could also increase up to 132 million by the end of the year. It's a huge magnitude of what we are going to face. And I could go on about the far-reaching consequences of this pandemic, but I think now is the time that we need to leverage our existing CSR initiatives to mitigate the further damage. And our members, for example, could expand their geographical reach, and we can use our expertise in building much more needed capacity in healthcare, especially in training the healthcare workers. And that's where I think companies through their CSR activities can certainly play a role. And I certainly believe that we can explore ways in which we can collaboratively work where interventions can reach a larger scale. And members, for example, can forge partnership at different levels of the government, starting with, say, the Gram Panchayats for field level interventions. It could be collaborating with the state, for example, or go all the way to the central government, where we can bring about policy level changes, which would then help our interventions at the corporate social responsibility. And I hope that today that this report that we're releasing will certainly help a number of our member companies to expand their interventions, not only strategically, but also innovatively, so that as we continue to serve the society, I understand that the road ahead will be challenging, but our members are not new to challenges. And through a concerted effort, I believe that we can continue to work towards achieving the developmental goals of the country. So once again, thank you for your attention, and I'm very, very happy to be participating in this webinar.